Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The news articles along with the page numbers are displayed here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles is given in the description box as well as in the comment section. Now let us start our today's news analysis. This editorial article is with respect to the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Before entering the editorial analysis, let us first see the much criticized provision in the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019, which says that provided that any person belonging to Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain, Parsi or Christian community from Afghanistan, Bangladesh or Pakistan who entered into India on or before 31st day of December 2014 and who has been exempted by the central government by or under Class C of Subsection 2 of Section 3 of the Passport Act of 1920 or from the application of the provisions of the Foreigners Act of 1946 or any rule or order made thereunder shall not be treated as the illegal migrant for the purposes of this Act. So, this Amendment Act of 2019 introduces this provision in Section 2 of the Citizenship Act of 1955. The Amendment Act mentions that any person belonging to Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain, Parsi or Christian community from Afghanistan, Bangladesh or Pakistan who entered into India on or before the 31st day of December 2014 should not be treated as illegal migrant. The major criticism is that the Parliament has not included Islam religion, which has the second largest following within India. And the grounds mentioned for such an amendment is that the persons belonging to these six religious communities have undergone persecution on the grounds of religion in these three countries. So, with this background, let us see the editorial article. The author's main argument is that this provision in the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 fails the constitutional test. The first argument put forward is that many communities, even in Islamic religion, were also subjected to persecution in some of these countries. In such a case, excluding such persecuted Muslims amounts to violation of right to equality among the migrants. So, to substantiate the argument, the authors quote the stand taken by India at the 38th session of the UN Human Rights Council in 2018. The Indian representative mentioned about the stand of Pakistan with respect to some Islamic persons who are persecuted in Pakistan. India has mentioned that Pakistan has unleashed systemic persecution against its own Muslim minorities, including Shias, Ahmadiyyas, Ismailia and Hazaras, and such persecution is routinely carried out in Pakistan. The authors have also highlighted the situation of Ahmadiyyas in Pakistan. It is reported that Ahmadiyyas, who are considered as minorities within Muslim religion, they have to declare themselves as non-Muslims if they want to vote in elections in Pakistan. So, based on these points, one can say that the provision in Citizenship Amendment Act envisages a discrimination among those who were persecuted in Pakistan. Then, also the stand made by India at the international forum contradicts the stand made by India at the national arena. Now, the next part of the editorial deals with the defining religious persecution. For example, Ahmadis in Pakistan are Muslims according to their belief. But the government in Pakistan is not ready to consider them as Muslims. So, the authors are mentioning that religion has to be understood not from the believer's point of view, rather it is about what it means to its adversaries. So, in this example, Ahmadis are the believers and the Pakistan government functionaries are the adversaries of these believers. So, we can understand that the persecution is more if you see it from the adversary's point of view. In this regard, the authors highlight the statement made by Dr. Radhakrishnan, who was the former president of India. He quoted that no person shall suffer any form of disability or discrimination because of his religion. He also said that no one religion should be given preferential status or unique distinction, that no one religion should be accorded special privileges in national life. Then he also mentioned that Indian concept of secularism means equal status to all religions. Then the article talks about how the provision disregards the persons who are persecuted on various grounds other than the grounds of religion. There could be persecution on linguistic lines or on the lines of political affiliations. Also, the Citizenship Amendment Act did not recognize the atheist. They could have also suffered persecution at the three countries. So, there is a discrimination because of the understanding that someone must have undergone persecution only on the basis of religion. Then the author says that people are being misinformed that the partition of India is based on religious lines. But the authors mention that the partition of India was based on a philosophical understanding of the nature of society as wanted by both the citizens and then leaders. That is, Pakistan opted for a theocratic nature of governance, that is, Islamic theocratic nature of governance, but India's founding fathers adopted a plural, inclusive and modern society which is to be based on democratic and secular credentials. So, if partition is based on religion, India would also become a Hindu state at the time of independence. But this was not so, and India is based on secularism. This was one of the reasons why founding fathers of India mentioned liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship in the preamble of Indian Constitution. And India has also made the right to freedom of religion as a fundamental right in Part 3 of the Indian Constitution. So, in such a case, one cannot say that the partition of India and Pakistan was based on religious lines. Though Pakistan's governance might be based on the state religion as Islam, India has no state religion as it is based on secularism. Then finally, the authors conclude the article by expressing hope that the Indian government will display an accommodative approach. The authors have mentioned the quote of Edmund Burke. The quote reads as, "Magnanimity in politics is not seldom the truest wisdom, and a great empire and little minds go ill together." This quote can be interpreted for our context as having an accommodative approach in politics is always the truest wisdom, and narrow-mindedness or little minds will be detrimental for a great democracy. So, at that time, unrest against British oppressive rule was going on in some of the American colonies, and Edmund Burke spoke this quote in British Parliament so that Britain has to accommodate to the American colonies. He asked the British government not to push for harsh taxation and military suppressions in response to unrest in the American colonies. So, the author's point is that for the unrest with respect to Citizenship Amendment Act, India, which is a great democracy, can show magnanimity by accommodating persons who were persecuted even in Muslim religion and also those who were persecuted based on other reasonable grounds. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this editorial. In this article, we have seen how the Citizenship Amendment Act ignores the persecution of Muslim minorities in Pakistan. Then we saw about other grounds of persecution which are not included in Citizenship Amendment Act. Then finally, we saw few information about partition of India. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the recent locust invasion in Gujarat. So in this contest, we will be discussing about locust, then about locust swarm and their impact on environment, and also the preventive measures in order to check locust invasion. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. If you look at insects, they are very much associated with human beings' life. Some are useful and some are highly harmful. And one of the most harmful insects in the world is the desert locust. So, in this context, we'll be discussing about locust species. They are the members of grasshopper family Acridiidae, which includes most of the short-horned grasshoppers. Locust species differ from grasshoppers because these species have the unique capability to change their behavior and physiology in response to the changes in population density and also the other factors such as relative humidity, soil moisture, then rainfall pattern, and temperature, including availability of food, that is green vegetation for locust species. Now we'll see the migration pattern in locust. Locusts are highly migratory in nature, that is, under favorable ecological conditions, adult locust may congregate or form swarm, that is, large group of locust known as locust swarm. Locust swarm may contain millions of individuals having tendency to migrate in a unit, and they follow the direction of the wind movement. Locust species have voracious feeding behavior, that is, great appetite for eating, and they can cause great devastation to natural and cultivated vegetation. So they can have the potential to cause a national emergency of food and fodder. And these species are desert locust, migratory locust, Bombay locust and tree locust, as shown in the pictures. Among these four species, the desert locust is most important pest species in India as well as in intercontinental. Now, let us discuss the present migratory pattern of locust species. The locust species originally emerged from countries in the Horn of Africa, such as Sudan and Eritrea. Then they travel to Saudi Arabia and then to Iran. Then they finally enters into Pakistan, where they invaded the Sindh province. And from there, they moved into Rajasthan and Gujarat. Kindly notice that the locust species have a tendency to form swarm, that is, large groups if heavy rainfall is available. Now, if you look at the news article, which says that Gujarat is under attack from Hopos, that is, newborn locust species. The locust swarm have devastated agricultural farms in several border districts of Gujarat and Rajasthan. These locust species are locally known as tiddies, which have mainly affected crops such as castor, cumin, jatropha, cotton and other fodder crops. Now, if you look at the past history of locust invasion in the states of India, that is, Indian states of Rajasthan and Gujarat have suffered from locust swarms in the past as well. But the news article says that the current swarm in Gujarat is the largest in the recent times. The widespread attack by locust species was reported during 1926 to 1931. Therefore, the then imperial government considered the necessity of a centralized organization for locust intelligence and control in the country. Therefore, the British imperial government established a locust warning organization in 1939. Presently, this organization, that is locust warning organization, is headed by a plant protection advisor, and it is an important division under the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation in Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. This organization gives warnings about the possibility of locust swarm incursion and their movement and also breeding pattern. Now, if you look at the present invasion, the state administration failed to prepare for swarm invasion despite alerts from the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization of a massive locust attack in South Asia, that is covering Pakistan and India. Despite these warning notices by Locust Warning Organization and Food and Agriculture Organization, the preventive measures were not taken by the respective authorities. Now, we'll discuss the different preventive measures that are needed to tackle locust invasion. The news article says that these insects fly in during the daytime and settle on the farms at night times. So, it is difficult to prevent from locust invasion. Here the measures includes one of the age-old technique, that is to beat drums to scare the locust, and then aerial sprinkling of insecticides, pesticides and chemicals can be used to reduce the impact of locust invasion. Though the authorities have started these measures, the article says that it is too little to prevent the menace and it is also too late to reduce the impact of locust invasion. Now, the government has assured farmers to carry out a survey to assess the damages and will accordingly compensate farmers. So, in the context of this news article, we have discussed about locust species, then about locust swarm and their impact on agriculture crops and environment, and we also discussed preventive measures to check locust invasion. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article. This news article says, on the birth anniversary of former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi launched Atal Bhushal Yojana and also named the strategic tunnel under Rohtang Pass after Vajpayee. So in this context, we'll be discussing about Rohtang Pass and also in detail about Atal Bhushal Yojana. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Kindly notice that Bhushal means groundwater. The Atal Bhushal Yojana has been designed with the principal objective of strengthening the institutional framework for participatory groundwater management and bringing about behavioral changes at the community level for sustainable groundwater resources management in 7 states. These states are Gujarat, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Rajasthan and Karnataka. These states have been selected mainly based on different parameters such as degree of groundwater exploitation and groundwater degradation and established legal and regulatory instruments, and then based on institutional readiness and also based on experience in implementing initiatives related to groundwater management. Kindly notice that the Atal Bhushal Yojana comes under Ministry of Jal Shakti. The implementation of the scheme is expected to benefit about 8,350 gram panchayats in 7 states. The scheme will promote panchayat-led groundwater management and behavioral change with primary focus on demand-side management. Now, let us understand the funding pattern of the scheme. You know that there are 2 types of government schemes, that is centrally sponsored scheme and central sector scheme. Under central sector scheme, 100% is funded by the central government. But in case of centrally sponsored scheme, the funding is shared between the states and central government. The Atal Bhushal Yojana is a central sector scheme. The total outlay is about 6,000 crores to be spent over a period of 5 years. 50% of the total fund shall be in the form of World Bank loan and be repaid by the central government. The remaining 50% shall be through the central assistance from regular budgetary support. Entire World Bank's loan component and the central assistance shall be passed on to the states as a grants. The scheme provides active participation of the communities in various activities such as formation of water use association, then monitoring and disseminating groundwater data, then water budgeting, then preparation and implementation of gram panchayat wise water security plans, and then information, education and communication activities related to sustainable groundwater management. Now, if you look at the news article, the Prime Minister of India has said that India must be prepared to deal with every situation of water crisis. The central and state governments would spend about 3.5 lakh crores on water related schemes in the next 5 years. So in this context, it is important to know another important mission, that is Jal Jeevan Mission, which was also launched by Ministry of Jal Shakti. The objective of Jal Jeevan Mission is to ensure piped water supply to all rural households by 2024. This mission is expected to benefit approximately 14.6 crore rural households by 2024. This mission comes under the Department of Drinking Water and Sanitation in Ministry of Jal Shakti. The mission focuses on creation of local infrastructure for source sustainability, that is like rainwater harvesting, then groundwater recharge and management of household wastewater for reuse in agriculture. Now, if you look at the news article, it also mentions about the tunnel under Rohtang Pass, which has been named after former Prime Minister Vajpayee. Know that the tunnel will connect Manali in Himachal Pradesh with Leh in the Union Territory of Ladakh. The tunnel is about 8.8 kilometers in length, which is nearing its completion. Once it is completed, it will be the world's longest tunnel above an altitude of 3000 meters. This will help to reduce the travel time between Manali and Leh. It will also provide all-weather connectivity to remote border areas of Himachal Pradesh and Ladakh, and it is also expected to give a boost to tourism in the region. So, in the context of this news article, we have discussed about Atal Bhushal Yojana, then about Jal Jeevan Mission, and also about Rohtang Pass. So, with this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. These news articles are about census, NPR, NRIC and Citizenship Amendment Act. So in this context, first we shall be discussing about census and NPR, and then we will compare census and NPR, then we shall see NRIC and the link between NPR and NRIC. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of these news articles is highlighted here for your reference. Now let us see about census. Census is conducted once in every 10 years under the legal provisions of Census Act of 1948 and the Census Rules of 1990. A variety of statistical information on different characteristics of the people of India will be collected during the census. The census details are maintained by the Office of the Registrar General and Census Commissioner under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Census provides detailed and authentic information on demography, then economic activity, then housing and household amenities, and other details such as literacy and education, then about urbanization, then about fertility and mortality rates, then about scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, then also about language, religion, migration and disability, etc. The next census will be held in 2021. The Census of India 2021 would be conducted in two phases. The first phase is the house listing and housing census, which will be conducted from April 2022 to September 2020. And the second phase is the population enumeration, which will be conducted from 9th to 28th February 2021. So this is all about census that you need to know. Here you also have to note that the National Population Register will also be updated along with the house listing and housing census, except in the state of Assam, because NRC exercise has already been carried out in the state of Assam. Now we'll see about National Population Register. It is a register of usual residents of the country. The objective of the National Population Register is to create a comprehensive identity database of every usual resident in the country. This register contains three elements of data of a usual resident, that is the demographic data, then the biometric data and the Aadhaar number. The NPR, that is National Population Register, is also to be maintained by the Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India. Here, a usual resident is defined as a person who has resided in a local area for the past 6 months or more, or a person who intends to reside in that area for the next 6 months or more. So we can say usual residents include citizens as well as non-citizens. NPR is prepared and maintained at the local level, then at sub-district level, then at district level, then at state and national levels. NPR draws its authority from the provisions of the Citizenship Act of 1955 and the Citizenship Rules of 2003. See, the data for NPR was collected in 2010 along with the house listing phase of Census of India 2011. Then the updation of this data was done during 2015 by conducting door-to-door survey. Now it has been decided to update the National Population Register. Let us see the comparison of census with the National Population Register. See, the census is conducted for the population of India, whereas NPR collects details from the non-citizens as well. The next difference is that the census collects wide information on demography, then about economic activity, then about housing and household amenities, etc. So it contains only the demographic particulars, whereas if you see NPR, it would contain demographic as well as biometric details. The next difference is that during every census, data is collected fresh. So every time the data is collected fresh and uploaded in the database. Now the government has planned to update NPR in all the states and union territories except in the state of Assam. It is because NRC exercise has already been conducted in the state of Assam. Now we'll see about National Register of Indian Citizens, that is NRIC. See, National Population Register is the universal data set of usual residents, and it contains both citizens as well as non-citizens. Out of this universal data set, the citizenship status of individuals will be verified and included in the National Register for Indian Citizens. So we can clearly see that those individuals who are not able to establish themselves as citizens of India or any other nation have every possibility to be declared as illegal migrants. Kindly notice that NRIC will also be prepared at local level, then at sub-district level, then at district level and state levels after verifying the citizenship status of the residents. So we can see that NPR is the first step to NRIC. This is the reason why the government has planned to update NPR in all the states and union territories except in the state of Assam. Now we'll see the legal backing of NRIC. Kindly notice that NRIC draws its legality as per the Section 14A of Citizenship Act of 1955. This Section 14A provided for the compulsory registration of every citizen of India and the issue of a national identity card. So as per this section, NRIC has to be maintained. So for this purpose, the central government shall establish a national registration authority and the Registrar General of India shall act as the national registration authority and he will also function as the Registrar General of Citizen Registration. So from this we can say that there is a clear link between NPR and NRIC. But the Union Minister for Home Affairs has said that there was no link between National Population Register and NRIC. So this is all about census, then about NPR and NRIC in detail. Now if you see one of the news articles, the Vice President of a regional political party from Bihar has said that there was a state connection between the Citizenship Amendment Act and the NRIC and the National Population Register. So in this context we have discussed about census, then about National Population Register, then about National Register of Indian Citizens. With this we have come to the end of analysis of these news articles. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next news article. This data point news article is based on the report on trend and progress of banking in India 2018-19. This report is released by the RBI on 24th December 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. In this data point, you can see the terms such as non-performing assets, stressed assets, then special mention account 1 and then special mention account 2. We'll see the definitions of these terms so that you can understand the news article in a better way. Now, if you look at the definition of asset, which refers to the loans or advances that are given by the banks. If the interest and the principal are paid in the period fixed by the bank, then the assets are called as performing assets. If not, that is, if an asset stops to generate income for the bank, then it is called as a non-performing asset. Therefore, as per RBI, a non-performing asset shall be a loan or an advance where interest or installment of principal remain overdue for more than 90 days. And this is applicable with respect to a term loan. So when we say overdue, it refers to an amount that is not paid on the due date fixed by the bank. Kindly notice that if an advance is granted for agricultural purpose, such an advance becomes non-performing asset if interest and or installment of principal remains overdue for two harvest seasons. So this is the definition of non-performing assets. Now let us see the categories of non-performing assets. There are three categories of non-performing assets. They are substandard assets, then doubtful assets and loss assets. That is, when a loan remains as a non-performing asset for a period less than or equal to 12 months, then the asset is classified as substandard asset. Then, when the asset remains in substandard category for a period of 12 months, then the asset is called as doubtful asset. A doubtful asset means that the collection of the principal or the interest has become highly questionable and improbable. So, when a loan asset is identified as a loss by bank or by auditors or by RBI inspection, then it is called as a loss asset. Now, we'll see about stressed assets. That is, what do you mean by stressed assets? Whether both stressed assets and non-performing assets mean one and the same? Know that technically, stressed assets and non-performing assets do not mean one and the same. This is because stressed assets refer to those assets for which payment is wholly or partly overdue between 1 to 90 days. Either payment refers to interest payment or principal payment. But in case of non-performing assets, the time for overdue is more than 90 days. But in case of stressed assets, it is 1 to 90 days. Now, we'll see about special mention accounts mentioned in the data point. See, stressed assets are classified into three categories. They are called as special mention accounts. There are three special mention accounts. They are special mention account 0, then special mention account 1, then special mention account 2. See, if the payment is overdue for a period of 1 to 30 days, then the asset comes under special mention account 0 category. Then, if the payment is overdue for a period of 31 to 60 days, then the asset comes under special mention account 1. If the payment is overdue for a period of 61 to 90 days, then the asset comes under special mention account 2 category. Now, with this background, let us see the news article. It talks about the share of gross non-performing assets to the total loans, which is also called as GNPA ratio. Its speciality is that the GNPA ratio of all scheduled commercial banks declined in 2018-19 after rising for 7 consecutive years. We can also see the drop of GNPA ratio for the public sector banks in the period, that is from March 2018 to March 2019. The report given by RBI mentions two reasons for the improvement of GNPA ratio. These reasons are the decline in the slippage ratio and the reduction in outstanding GNPAs. We have given you the definition of slippage ratio for better understanding. Now, let us see the second part of the data point. This part mentions that while there is a drop in GNPA ratio for scheduled commercial banks and public sector banks, but the stressed assets have increased in the first half of financial year of 2019 to 2020. Here, the first half corresponds to the period, that is from April 2019 to September 2019. In the same period, the number of special mention accounts 1 and 2 also increased. Now, come to the third part of the data point. As per RBI's report, the non-performing loans ratio is the highest for India within the group of 10 emerging economies including India, and this ratio is about 9.2%. Note that the data for Russian Federation is not available, and for the other 8 emerging economies, no country has the non-performing loans ratio more than 4.1%. So, these are the key takeaways from this data point news article. Therefore, in this analysis of this news article, we have seen the definition of NPA, then the classification of non-performing assets, then we saw about stressed assets and the classification of stressed assets, then we discussed the news article about GNPA ratio, then stressed assets and where India stands among the 10 emerging economies in terms of non-performing loans ratio. The display practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now, let us start our practice question session. Now, consider this question. They have given census, then national population register, then national register for Indian citizens. Which of the above are maintained or to be maintained by Registrar General of India? So, for this question, option D, that is 1, 2 and 3 is the correct option, because census is maintained by the Office of the Registrar General and Census Commissioner. As per Census Act of 1948, the Registrar General is the Census Commissioner in India. Then, in case of NRIC, that is National Register for Indian Citizens, the Registrar General of India functions as the Registrar General of Citizen Registration as per Section 14A of Citizenship Act of 1955. Therefore, Registrar General of India maintains the National Register of Indian Citizens. Kindly notice that NPR, that is National Population Register, is also maintained by the National Register of Indian Citizens based on Citizenship Rules of 2003. So, for this question, option D, that is 1, 2 and 3 is the correct option. Now look at this question. They have given two statements and you have to choose the statements which are incorrect. First statement says that in India the state governments have the authority to conduct census whenever they may consider necessary. Then the second statement says that the National Register of Indian Citizens is updated and maintained by the respective state governments. Here both the statements are incorrect because census comes under the union list in 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution. So the central government has the ultimate authority in the matters of census operations. So first statement is incorrect statement. Know that as per Census Act of 1948, the central government has the authority to conduct census. The central government can issue a notification declaring its intention of conducting a census whenever it considers necessary. Kindly notice that as per Rule 11 of Citizenship Rules 2003, the Registrar General of Citizen Registration has to update and maintain the National Register of Indian Citizens. Therefore, Registrar General of India functions as the Registrar General of Citizen Registration as per the Section 14A of Citizenship Act of 1955. So for this question, you have to choose the incorrect statements. So option C, both 1 and 2 is the correct option for this question. Now look at this question. This question says, why is a species called Cystocerca gregaria often mentioned in news? So they have given four options and you have to choose the correct option. Option A says it tends to reduce the indigenous fish diversity in freshwater lakes. Then option B says its extract is used for making synthetic textiles. Then option C says it is a low-cost species which can cause great damage to natural and cultivated vegetation. So for this question, option C, that is Cystocerca gregaria, is the scientific name of desert locust which can cause great devastation to natural and cultivated vegetation. Now look at this reference question which was asked in UPSC prelims 2018. The question says, why is a plant called Prosopis juliflora often mentioned in news? They have given four options and you have to choose the correct option. Option A says its extract is widely used in cosmetics. Then option B says it tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area in which it grows. Then option C says its extract is used in the synthesis of pesticides. Kindly notice that Prosopis juliflora has become an invasive weed in several countries including in India where it was introduced. So for this question, option B, that is it tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area in which it grows. So for this question, option B is correct because it tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area in which it grows. Look at this question. They have given two statements and you have to choose the correct statements. Statement 1 says that both non-performing assets and stressed assets mean one and the same. Then second statement says special mention accounts or stressed assets, if not addressed, can become non-performing assets in future. So for this question, first statement is incorrect because non-performing assets and stressed assets are not one and the same. So in case of non-performing assets, the overdue is more than 90 days. But in case of stressed assets, the overdue period is between 1 to 90 days only. Now look at the second statement. It says that special mention accounts or stressed assets and if not addressed can become non-performing assets in future. If you look at the definition of special mention accounts, they are classified based on the overdue period. Say if the overdue period is 1 to 30 days, it is known as special mention account of 0 category. Then if the overdue is from 31 to 60 days, then it is known as special mention account of 1 category. Then if the overdue period is from 61 to 90 days, then it is known as special mention accounts of 2nd category. So if the special mention accounts are not addressed, then they are prospective accounts to become non-performing assets in the next cycle or in the future. So for this question, option B, that is 2 only, is the correct option. Now look at this question. This question is based on report on Trend and Progress of Banking in India for 2018-19, which is released by RBI. And they have given two statements and you have to choose the correct statements. Statement 1 says that the gross non-performing assets ratio of all scheduled commercial banks declined in 2018-19 after rising for 7 consecutive years. Then second statement says India's non-performing loans ratio has been in the higher range in the last 5 years in the emerging economies category. So for this question, option C, that is both 1 and 2, is the correct option. Here statement 1 is correct because as per the report released by RBI, they have mentioned two reasons, that is drop in slippage ratio and reduction in gross non-performing assets, as the reasons for decline in the gross non-performing assets of all scheduled commercial banks. Therefore, statement 1 is correct. Now, second statement is also correct because as per the RBI report on trend and progress of banking in India, if you observe, since 2016, India's NPL ratio has been in the higher range among the emerging economies category. So for this question, option C, that is both 1 and 2, is the correct option. With this, we have come to the end of the today's Indian news analysis. If you like the video, please do like, share, comment and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates. Thank you.